It feels so good to hear those old familiar songs once again. And I can't recall how long it's been since I've seen my friends. They paved our fields and taken the saw to what our hearts have known and loved.
All right. Very great. So much clarity has been coming in that I don't even know what to say, except I will say that it is, let's say it's harvest time, because it really is. It's really harvest time.
When I hear the wind in the trees, oh, it feels like the...
And how to go about that situation, what to say when the clarity just becomes so great, you're at a loss for words. Seeing the future is the future has become very, very transparent, very transparent. And just, it is what we thought it is. It will be what we thought it will be. We're right about it. Which begs the question, what to do about it? And that leads to the sort of cover-all blanket term of harvest time, the harvest.
Well, I like the country again. It feels like a long lost friend. Driving down the road, it helps me light my load. I'm headed back to my home. There's a life there to call my own. The wind in my hair, the clean fresh air, feels like the country.
We're headed back to our home. There's a place there to call our own. Wind in our hair, the clean fresh air. It feels like the country. Yeah. Question is, what to do at this point? Now I have some pretty good ideas. And what these videos have been trying to convey is the importance of hanging out in satsang. So let's get into that. There is something that is possible to help us, actually. The best way to proceed with the future, the days of our lives, is to literally be able to simply hang out with someone who has accepted reality as it is. Plain and simple. That's it. Next best thing would be to hang out with videos from someone who has accepted reality as it is. Now, the whole question that we have is, well, what would that be like? And that is what I have trained for so long to be able to get that answer. The answer is, it seems perfectly normal. It seems very normal. It's not difficult at all. It is not like going down the rabbit hole. The truth is that it is following the narrative of existence that's going down the rabbit hole. When you follow the narrative of existence, you will really feel as if you're going down the rabbit hole and getting into an extremely bizarre Mad Hatter's Tea Party situation. Whereas if you hang out with those who have accepted reality as it is, you feel like, this is very sane, very normal. This is what I want. This isn't weird at all. That's the feeling you get. So, but the world, the belief system, the intellect that seems to be the authority of existence, it claims that hanging out with those who accepted reality as it is totally bizarre, totally weird. You're gonna go down the rabbit hole and just, it's gonna get totally, totally weird, totally dangerous, totally strange. And they think that following the narrative of existence, you'll feel normal. Everything will feel normal to you. It won't be weird at all. They have it completely backwards, upside down and backwards. So it is struggling against this false value system, false emphasis, false belief system that is so difficult, because we just assume that it must be valid. We say, no, if we are hanging out with someone who's accepted reality as it is, that's going to be really crazy. And this was exacerbated by those so-called gurus who are called themselves crazy wisdom gurus, who hanging out with him really was weird and really was crazy. and they said what they're, you know, they're like the Uber gurus, and this is what they're here to really help us. But so that gave it a very bad name, hanging out with those who accept reality as it is. It gave it a bad name, and people are. It was a red herring. It was a false flag. It was a psychop operation. It was a way to discourage us from hanging out with those who accept the truth as it is, believing that it's going to get very exploitive, very weird, very crazy. And there were these gurus during the 70s, 60s, 70s, 80s, even into the 90s, etc., who did exploit their devotees, who did treat them very crazily, who were control freaks, who it was weird. It was weird, and that is the image that then the ego projected into the world of this is what's like. But fortunately, there are some who were aware of some true gurus, from those who have truly accepted reality as it is, who are not that way at all, like Ramana Maharshi, Anandamayi Ma, those types, who Punjaji, who simply said, come and just hang out, abide quietly here in peace with me, and you will get the flavor of accepting reality as it is. That's it. And that wasn't weird. That wasn't weird. It's not weird. It's not weird when you come across those who are legitimate. It's not a weird situation at all. The assumptions, we have all these assumptions, it's going to be really weird. No, it's not. So that is the remedy for the times. It is actually the remedy. It is the sovereign remedy for these times. Because the way to sail through these times and the situation that's coming up upon the world is to accept reality as it is. And again, to consent and accept gravitating towards accepting reality as it is right now. That is literally all we have to do. That's it. Nothing more than that. And the best way to do that is to hang out with those who have accepted reality as it is, right now. There is no better way. So I've always aimed for that. And so far I have not found any situation to hang out in. I expect I will. I expect I will. It should go that way. Because especially for those who recognize what the future is all about, which I most certainly do. I was going to make a video this morning to really expose it even more, but then I realized, hey, that's really going to get me in trouble. There's no question about it. If you lay out how this whole thing is going to unfold, which I have a pretty good idea of now, they don't like that. Those who want to take over control of this planet, they don't like having their plans exposed before. They like to have it come as a surprise. And it's really not necessary to lay it out that way. I had to decide, what am I going to do? It's better to emphasize how to escape the whole thing. Because you're going to be targeted anyway. Because they will feel as if you are a legitimate target because you're interfering with their plans and they're here to save the world and you're interfering with that. So you deserve to be targeted and eliminated, even if that's not what you're about at all. You might just be telling people how to be saved from the situation, but they don't see it that way. They do not see it that way, and that is what I saw this morning. They don't see it that way at all. So it doesn't matter how good of a nice person you are, who's helping humanity, trying to help everyone. No, you're either with them or against them from their standpoint. You either submit or you're against them, and you're a dangerous person, needs to be eliminated. So the real answer is to find out where your safety is. That is the answer. Not to try and tweak their noses and spill the beans and say exactly what's going to happen, because that's not going to get you into safety. And you will most certainly be targeted coming up. There's no question about it. Many of the whistleblowers have already been targeted, actually. So the key is to find out where your safety is. That is the key. And the safety ultimately is to gravitate towards, to choose and consent right now to gravitating towards accepting reality as it is right now. That is the absolute key to your safety, to your sanctuary, to your refuge, to your protection. And so we need to keep focusing on that. Even though I could have the capability of actually producing some tremendous videos. I've practiced on that for many years in the past, and I know I could do it right now. It would take a lot of work for sure. Maybe, you know, immerse myself in it for like a week or two. Maybe get 100 views or something. But all that time would be wasted, because the thing is, we already know, most of us already know, the future is entirely problematic. And we need to gravitate towards safety. All right, and how to do that? Well, again, the way to do it is we have to get the ball rolling as far as hanging out with those who have accepted reality as it is. And I'm trying to use this term. It's a more descriptive term than like, say, guru or savior or avatar or whatever. Those have all sorts of negative connotations that the belief system has seen to make sure to undermine people's opinions of gurus, etc., saying that's a really bad thing, dangerous thing, etc. It's a more descriptive term to say those who have accepted reality as it is, because that is literally what they have done. That is literally a spot-on description, accurate description of what they've done, and that's all they're doing. When they're there, they're just hanging out with reality as it is themselves. That's all they're doing. They're just enjoying it, abiding in it. Ramana said, simply abiding in the self. They said, what are you doing? Ramana said, I'm just abiding in the self, capital S. In other words, reality as it is. That's all he was doing. And he just invited those who want to come sit quietly and hang out with them just to do that too. And get the flavor. Get the flavor. Get the feel of it. Say, ah, this isn't dangerous. This is not scary. This feels very normal, very natural, and very safe. And get the flavor of it. That's the secret. That is the key, literally the key, which I've always put the super emphasis on those who have accepted reality as it is being very helpful in this world. A Course in Miracles doesn't emphasize that, and it says it's a self-study course, but I believe it prepares you for that. Now, it tells you that you need to accept it for yourself. Well, that's easier said than done in today's world, actually. So far, I don't know anyone from A Course in Miracles who's actually truly accepted reality as it is. I don't know a single one. There are those who say that they have, but from my standpoint, I don't know anyone that has actually done it. So that's not a good track record. In other words, it means there's a further step we have to take. We have to take a further step, and that is literally gravitating towards hanging out with those who have accepted reality as it is. And not simply demanding that we have to do it ourselves. We have to do it ourselves. There's nobody's going to help us. That's nonsense. Just last century, there were a number of those in this world. I don't know how many, but there was quite a handful of those who had actually accepted reality as it is here in the world for people to hang out with. So why at this crucial juncture in history, in our destiny, where the whole ball of wax is right on the table here, and crucial decisions need to be made, and the future of this planet, even though it seems to be bright, is a false brightness, a false light, and is going to turn extremely dark. When we have to decide to gravitate towards accepting reality as, why shouldn't there be also a handful of those who have accepted reality as it is? Why not? That we can hang out from. There needs to be a handful of them, because not everyone's is everyone's cup of tea. There are different people different styles appeal to different people. They have a appearance, they have some way of conveying it, and it's just different. We will be attracted to various different ones. I don't think there should just be one. There should be a handful of them, actually. And it should be now. It should be now, because the decision time is now, right in front of us, right in front of us. Events are moving at a quantum rate almost in the world, and the troubles, the solidification of the New World Order, of the New World Cycle, and submission to those who are supposedly leading the authorities of that, of how to implement that, is 1 minute, please. Okay. It's going very quickly. Very, very quickly. And we have to get with it very, very quickly. It's just my wonderful neighbors are there. So again, I'm trying to lay the groundwork for this, trying to pave a road, a bridge, as it were, to bridge over to that experiencing. A bridge to get so we can experience hanging out with those who have accepted reality as it is. Now, there might be a few in this world that have done that. But I'm kind of iffy. I couldn't say unequivocally that there is. I really cannot. Really cannot. There's a certain different quality about those who have truly done it, and it's like, wow. It's a really tremendous wow factor. But not an overwhelming awe factor, really, if you have been educated properly, been prepared properly. If you just understand what it's about, you say they just accepted reality as it is, and they're just here to give us that flavor of that, and all we have to do is sit there and hang out with them. You can talk, you can hang out, you can ask questions, but it's very casual, kind of. There's some structure to it to make it optimize it, but just silently sitting there, just getting the flavor, getting the vibe. That's all, catching the vibe. Because you know what the purpose is you need to accept reality as it is. There's no intellectual component of that, really. And so, what's key is to feel that it's okay, that it's safe, and that this is it, this is real, this is okay. And be reassured. It's a exercise in reassurance, is what it is. And oftentimes, trying to ask all sorts of detailed questions just kind of confuses us. It's better just to kind of hang out. And there's a way to do it. There's a way to do it. And I studied the situation with Nanda Maima for a long, long time, and those who came to it. How is that? How did that take place? And I understand it, how it goes. Occasionally, people would ask questions when the mood was right, and a lot of times they just sit quietly. And everyone kind of understood the flow of the situation, and sometimes she'd answer questions, sometimes not. She'd just remain quiet. As if saying, don't worry about that question, just be reassured, just be reassured. And sometimes she would respond. It was very natural kind of situation. It wasn't stilted at all. So I have a sense like, yeah, it can be very accommodating, very, very natural, very smooth. Not weird at all, really. Can be very inspiring. But we need not try to inspire awe in any way. I'm not really for that. I'm not for somebody walking on water. Certainly they could, but I'm not really for that. I'm not really for physical miracles at all, because that tends to inspire awe, which is a distancing thing. And the whole idea is to say that reality, accepting, abiding in reality as it is not something you should be in awe of, because that is natural for us. So you shouldn't expect all sorts of whiz-bang stuff, miracles, all this kind of stuff. And, you know, if the few crop up now and then, okay, you notice them, say, okay, that's cool, and can get right back to catching the overall vibe. And maybe that's part of the vibe, is realizing that the capability of manifestation to manifest, and to for time and space to be rearranged, and for miracle, for delay to be discarded, etc. That's all part of it. It's not the central part of it. You don't go there for psychic experiences. You don't go for that stuff. You go for feeling, be reassured it's okay to accept reality as it is. It's that simple. If that's all that's in your heart, you've got it. If you go there, no, I just want to be reassured. That's all I'm here for. I'm not here to ask questions. You know, I feel like I got a sense that some satsang in the world is kind of like, you're sort of supposed to like go and ask questions and listen to someone else asking questions, etc. It would be great if you just go and you just feel like, no, I'm just here. I just want to sit here quietly. That's it. I don't have any intention of asking any questions. I'm not even thinking about anything like that. I just want to catch the vibe. That should be okay. I believe there's some teachers who that's what it's basically about, really. But you don't even have to be meditating. You don't have to be contemplating. You can just be experiencing the reassurance. That is actually higher than contemplation or meditation. It's higher. Because you have a very clear focus and understanding of what the situation, the purpose is, and then you're aligning with the purpose very very, very well. You're just soaking it in like a sponge. You're just soaking it in and saying, hey, this is okay. This is okay. This isn't frightening. This is not a problem. And then that helps you gravitate even more towards accepting reality as it is. And of course, reality can't be threatened. And since you are one with reality, you are an aspect of reality that is all just one. And if there's just one relationship with reality, relationship is reality with reality. That is the one relationship. You're already related to everything. Already related to everything perfectly. You don't have to try and establish relationships here. You're already related to everything. So just be reassured that that is true. So like when you're just sitting quietly, everyone's just hanging out. People are not busy networking, socializing, hooking up. It's not a hookups, cultural hookup situation at all. You may think, well, I need to hug everyone and tell how much I love them, etc. No, you don't, because you already have a relationship with everything, with the totality of reality, perfect relationship. You simply need to accept it as it is. Ananda Mama said she had a perfect relationship with everything. She said there is absolutely nothing, even in this dream, she said, there's nothing that arises that I don't feel perfect love for and have a perfect relationship with. Not even a speck of dust, or dog poo, or a snake, or whatever, everything. She said no exceptions. I have a perfect relationship of love with everything, effortlessly. So, and she said nothing special. She said, even my husband, I don't have any special relationship with him at all. I don't have a special relationship with any of you. I have a perfect relationship with everything, all that is. I have a perfect relationship with all that is, and we do too. The only difference is we're not accepting it because we want to try and change reality. So we're trying to deal with the problem of annihilation in this hypothetical scenario we call existence. But we don't have to do that. We can accept reality as it is. We can hang out with those who accept reality as it is. Nothing weird about it. There's not some complex teaching that needs to be given out. If any complex teaching needs to be given out, I could do that. Actually, Ananda Mama had those who gave out teaching, had those who helped her who did that. But she would mostly just sit quietly, not say anything. Not like she's in some kind of intense silent mode, or like, I'm just going to sit here and gaze in everyone's eyes silently. No. It was completely natural silence. Completely natural silence. Just love and state of relationship, perfect relationship with everything. Just abiding in that perfect relationship with everything. She might glance at you. They might glance at you very peacefully and very quietly, and then just go on. It's just a nod. Hey, everything's fine. I have a perfect relationship with everything, and so do you. It's not like she's saying, they won't say, I have some intense relationship with you, some loving relationship with you. No, they'd say, I accept your perfect relationship with all that is. That is what they're saying. Very simple. It's not difficult to get. So you're not going there to try to meet people, necessarily. You will, to some degree. But it's not about that necessarily. That's not the context. The context is you're just getting the flavor of being reassured that it's okay to accept the fact that you have a perfect relationship with all it is, and that reality, and you can accept reality as it is. Don't have to worry about any hypothetical annihilation, because there will never be any. This is the right context of the situation. So these videos are working to get us in. To at least appreciate the right context, so it makes it easy for us. I'll go first. That's not a problem for me if it comes up that way. I'm ready for it anytime. I'll hang out anytime with those who accepted reality as it is. And again, they're not going to ask you for explanations. They're not going to say, okay, how do you explain reality or something? No. You don't have to come there full of mental stuff. Mental concepts. You don't have to go there full of emotional concepts. You don't have to go there full of a bag of loving gestures or any of that kind of stuff, affectionate gestures. You don't have to come with any of that stuff. You can just come empty-handed, as it were. Just show up and say, no, I'm just here to just sit quietly and soak it all in. That's it. That's the best attitude. You don't have to be put on a show of anything. Because they already have a perfect relationship with everything. And they know that, so you do too. So they know that that is what you are. And this other is just an illusion. This other is just a hypothetical. It's just all the personality, the body, mind, is all hypothetical. The persona is totally hypothetical. The identity we think we are is totally hypothetical. Has no foundation in reality whatsoever. And so they know us as we really are, which has a perfect relationship with all that is, that which is perfectly included in all that is, and that which is totally immaculately safe and invulnerable and blissful forever and ever. They know that is what we are. So that's how they see us. So we don't have to do a song and dance to impress them at all. They're already completely and blissfully aware of how great, how perfect, how flawless we are. And they know that there's no concept that can give that to us. So we don't have to any story for them. We don't have any traumas for them. They know that this hypothetical is completely traumatic. So we don't have to go and explain our traumas to them at all. They already know that. They already know it's totally traumatic, and we will have run into a massive amount of traumas. No question about it. That's a given. It's a given. So we don't have to tell our sob stories to them at all. Not at all. Which is maybe a difficult thing for us, because we want someone to at least acknowledge how terrible it's been. But the key acknowledgement is how great reality is. Because just acknowledging how terrible existence has been doesn't free us from existence. Does not. So what we have to do is we have to have acknowledgement how great reality is. And I guarantee you that those who have accepted reality as it is know perfectly well the absolute horrendous nature of existence. No question about it. They know. And they know that you've been suffering terribly. It's a given. It is a given. And you don't have to try and impress them about how happy you are with existence. Because they know it's not a happy place. They're not telling you you're supposed to be happy with existence. How could they do that? How could they tell you to be happy with a torture chamber? They're just reassuring you that reality as it is flawless and perfect, and just accept it. You can accept it. That's it. That's it. So you don't feel like you have to dredge up all your traumas for them. It's not necessary. You don't have to act anything out. No acting is needed. And that is the great opportunity we should have coming for us. I'm not predicting it. I'm preparing for it. I'm not waiting for it. I'm preparing for it. And because it is something that I have foreseen taking place, but not in concrete detail. And it is yet to be determined. Is this going to take place or not? We will have to find out. But certainly we should prepare for it, because contesting the world is not the way. Battling the world is not the way. Fighting against the changes is not the way. Jesus told his disciples and those who listened to him, he said, don't resist Rome. That's not the right way. And of course Barabbas and those of the revolt who were planning to revolt against Rome, they didn't listen. And Jesus said, you see all the stones of these temples? There won't be a single one left standing on another. They'll all be pulled down very soon after I leave here. And that's what happened. The revolt against Rome did take place, and the Romans absolutely crushed this revolt and tore down all the buildings, all the temples. Didn't leave anything standing, really. Just decimated the country and then drove all the different tribes out of Israel, out of that area, and Judea, the whole area, and dispersed. They were dispersed to the winds. So Jesus knew what was coming. He knew that. He said, fighting against the man and the machine is not the way to do it. And it's not the way to do it now. It certainly wasn't the way to do it in Roman times. Instead, people could have just gone to Jesus and sat quietly with him and got reassured that it's perfectly fine to accept reality as it is. There's no problem with that whatsoever. Then they truly would have been able to literally ascend. That's not a problem for those who have accepted reality as it is. All sorts of options open up for them, all of which include safety. Refuge, sanctuary, all of which include that. Instead, they decided they wanted to fight it out, which is stupid. And there's a lot of people in the world right now who have the same perspective, which I've been trying to at least help those who want to be helped to get out of that perspective of fighting it out, because there's another option. There should be, even if nobody shows up, there's still the option of accepting reality as we can do that. Just sitting here in our own house, we can do that. That can happen. It doesn't have a great track record of doing that, but it is possible. Usually those who are ready come across someone who's already accepted reality as it is, and they kind of catalyze that. That is generally how it goes. Now, I haven't come across such a one in the flesh here in this world to catalyze. I have not. But I would certainly like to. I'm certainly preparing to, certainly planning to. The options other than that are not very good at all. Again, even if you're trying to be very accommodating to the New World Order, they will easily recognize that you're not with them. And if you're not with them, you're against them. And if you're against them, you literally are on the hit list, literally on the hit list. And you think, well, me? I wouldn't hurt a fly, which may be true, but you're still going to be on their hit list. That is something I saw very clearly this morning of how supremely intolerant they are of dissent, even if it's peaceful dissent. Supremely intolerant of it, literally to the extent you'll be on their hit list. And when you're on their hit list, that is not a good situation at all. You want to be in a place of safety. So it's super important to at least continue to consider this and consider it as preparation for safety. I know I'm asked, what do we do for safety? And again, these videos are all, I'm doing everything I possibly can for your safety. What I have paramount in my consideration is your safety. That's it. My safety, your safety, safety. I don't want harm to befall anybody. So with that in mind, I make these videos with that in mind. What can be done for your safety? And again, being reassured it's okay to accept reality as it is the ultimate thing you can do for your safety. It's better than buying guns and ammunition, believe me. Way better. Immeasurably better. It's immeasurably better than preparing to fight it out. Because as you are willing, as you are reassured to accept reality as it is, you bring very, very effective grace into your life. Call it miracles, call it time saving, call it grace, call it protection, call it the Passover principle. You bring a tremendous dynamic into play. Tremendous. Now, in Ananda Maya Ma's case, she was in East Bengal, and then during the partition of India, ceding East Bengal to Pakistan, became East Pakistan, there was extreme troubles there for Hindus, and there was a massive refugee problem. But she had actually relocated all her devotees who were willing to relocate ahead of time. And not one of them was harmed. They already relocated to India, and they didn't have the refugee problems that cropped up for so many millions who just had to flee at the last second. Now, there was a group who were taking care of a Kali Mandir Temple in Ramna Park, which is now Surawardi Udan. Surawardi Udan, which is just a part of Ramna Park in Dhaka. The temporary temple has been rebuilt in that area, but there were those who refused to leave, and they said, no, this is our home, this is our land, we've been here for so long, we will not leave, we will stay, we will overcome. In other words, they said, we will combat the situation, we're determined to keep this sacred temple going under all circumstances, and they refused to leave, and they were massacred during the Bengali liberation movement, which was the Bangladesh, the language movement turned into the Bangladesh Declaration of sovereign freedom from Western Pakistan. And at that time, the Western Pakistani troops and those who were working for them in Eastern Pakistan, which we call now Bangladesh, they came in, and one of the first things they did was they rounded up all the devotees at the Ramna Kali Mandir temple, and they brought them out and they massacred them. And a lot of those were the devotees of Anandamayi, but she told them all, hey, you need to relocate, and hey, if you don't, some way she conveyed in her way that you may end up being martyrs, and they were willing to be martyrs for what they believed in, and they said, this is our home, we're not leaving. Well, she always said that this world is just like a halfway house, is like a rundown inn, wayside inn, like some inn on a dirt road, rundown inn, dilapidated rundown inn. They said, this is not your home, it's just a temporary place, you go to a hotel, like a live-in hotel, you take a room in a hotel and you live in there for a while, but it's not your home. And so these people were so attached to what they felt was their home, they refused to relocate. Where others said, you know, if she tells us we need to relocate, we're going to do what she says. Because she never tells us to do anything without some very strong purpose behind it. So we're going to pay attention, do what she says. And so they did relocate, and they actually made out quite well, all of them. So there you have a parallel with right now, which I'm sure we'll be told we need to relocate in some way. We need to go to a place of safety because this world is going to be taken over by an extraterrestrial agenda, actually. It's going to take this world over. It's actually, the world has already been taken over. It's just that it hasn't been announced to us yet. Now, this is a very key thing that you need to hear. The world is, at this moment, is in the hands of the extraterrestrials and their lackeys here, their operatives. And those who are willing to sell out to them just for their own egoic glory. And they're already in the hands of the ETs. This whole planet is. It's just they have not officially announced. The official announcement hasn't been made. But I'm saying it's probably going to be made very soon. And you know very well who the one who's going to make that announcement. That's why he's in power. He's willing to do it. He's got the chutzpah to do that. Or the egomaniacal grandiosity of his historic mission to do that, to make the announcement. He will make that announcement at some point. And it will be gradually, the world will be given the word. The word will be passed out that, hey, the ETs are in charge. And they'll say, we are now in cooperation with them. We've signed a cooperation pact of some sort. But they're in charge right now. Right now. Have been for quite some time, actually. So, it is most certainly high time to be reassured to that it's okay to accept reality as it is. It is high time for that. We don't want to wait to the last second, like those who waited for the last second for the partitioning of India and East Bengal into East Pakistan. That partitioning, they got caught in the crosshairs for sure. And they were miserable. Holy cow. The refugees problem was insane. It was crazy. It was intense. People. It was just starvation. It was rampant disease. It was misery. And those refugees have still not got their feet on the ground entirely. It's still a problem. And yet those who got out ahead of time, they found very good situations, and she arranged it for them to have employment, have homes, to have support groups. Everything was arranged, and they went on with their lives very well, very well. So don't wait till the last second. Don't wait till the last second. Be reassured ahead of time. And so that's why I keep beating that drum. It is the super importance to be proactive and not wait till the last second. Do not wait for the announcements to be made and the new laws to be rolled out and to be told that we now have agreed to global governance and we're going to start implementing this. Why is this going? How is it possibly going to take place? Well, you already know pretty much how it's going to take place. There will be pretexts for it, probably, but basically, you know that the problems the world faced will be the pretext for it. The global warming, the energy crisis. We're going to be given free energy. We're be going to be given the technology to solve the global warming crisis. We're going to be given the technology to solve the war problem, to solve the starvation, solve the food problem, to solve the ozone problem, to solve this problem, to protect us from the sun. The sun is going to become dangerous, and they'll give the technology, all that stuff to protect the planet, to protect the people on it, et cetera, will be the pretext for that. And then people will just say, oh, great, 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 great. We'll accept then this new world order, this new structuring. We'll accept the one world currency. All this stuff will be the pretext for it, and people will go along with it. Most of the planet will go along with it. And then there's another group that will confront it, and there's another group who will simply relocate. Understanding when to hold them, when to fold them, when to walk away, when to run. They realize now's the time to fold their hands, walk away, and run. Get out of Dodge while getting out is good. Because again, I've seen very clearly how it will go, and it'll take a nasty dark turn at some point, or really bad. Because these ETs have a nasty temper, and they feel easily insulted, and they feel insubordination. When they feel that, they react in a very, very nasty way to that. Like the survival of their race is being threatened by it. They have a horrible temper, way worse than humans. Humans at least can respond to, we have various things we respond to. We can respond to humor, to someone who shows that it's not in bad intent, it's not mean-spirited what's going on, and we can get it. Only some crazy tyrants have not been able to get that. And even they had a soft spot. But the ETs are a different story altogether. We're dealing with something very different. We're not dealing with human nature. And they really don't get it when we try to say, hey, you know, it's not mean-spirited what we're doing. We're just, no. It's insubordination. Insubordination. And if you don't repent of it immediately, then they take that as you're willing to continue your insubordination, which means then you need to be dealt with ruthlessly. Because you're threatening their survival, period. And that's an end of sentence. No trial. No trials. There's no trials. Already we have the law now that's been, was it decreed that American citizens in foreign countries or even in America can be targeted for assassination it's deemed, without any trial, without any due process, if it's deemed that they're somehow terrorists or something like that, that they can, and already that's happened. Now, how about being potential terrorists? How about being dissenters? You know, it's a very slippery slope to get to the point of just where you're insubordinate, you see? And then you can literally, without any due process, be targeted for assassination here, and that's exactly what is going to take place. And people will just shrug their shoulders and say, "Well, that person was trying to against our survival. They refused to go along with how our survival, and so it's their own fault." They'll see them as being extremely wicked and deserving their fate. Where it might just been very peaceful dissenters saying, "Hey, This whole situation is going to take an extremely nasty turn in the future, and you need to realize that humans actually know how to deal with the situation better, and we have a right to have our voices heard and not to be put in this rigid hierarchical system of subordination to a top-down agenda. And yet they will be viewed as wicked, wicked people deserving of the extermination. So again, like those people in the Ramana Kali Mandir were incredibly loving, kind people, devoted people, wouldn't hurt a fly. I mean, they were they did absolutely nothing to deserve to be massacred, except what the East Pakistan the forces there wanted to crush any sense of unity and love for the country of East Bengal. And the Ramani Kali Mandir was a symbol of that. And so they just said, hey, this is extreme insubordination. This is going to, is threatening our agenda. So without any due process whatsoever, they just came in the night, rounded them all up, poof, slaughtered them all. Horrible. Men, women, and children. And burned them. And then bulldozed the temple. Simply, not because of anything they did, but simply because they were seen as a beacon of nationalism for Bangladesh, as part of that. And being people that could, a rallying point, it was a rallying point for people there. And so off with their heads. No due process. So we Americans believe that we'll have due process. We will not. You will not have due process. That is a very important issue to grapple with in your considerations. You will not have due process. You will be targeted and assassinated, period. No due process will be used in the future. And we've already seen the world going that direction very strongly now. With hardly a peep, there are a few people that stood up and say, hey, you're going down a very bad slope, slippery slope here, and this is unacceptable. People say, ah, well, yeah, we got rid of a bad guy, so what the heck? Yeah, but completely against the Constitution, completely against the Bill of Rights, completely against what any American should, every American is entitled to due process, and allegations can be made against everybody, right? That's what happened in the Soviet Union. Allegations were made against people, and they said, well, here we have the allegations. That's enough for us. Allegations are good enough. No due process. Same in communist China and in various places, right? North Korea. Allegations are enough. So if they want you out of the way, they'll just have pay someone to make some allegations against you or reward somebody for doing so. And then you're on the list and you're rubbed out. And we say, never could happen in America. It's already happened here. And the legal way is completely paid for that to take place. And as a way to pull people into line. And basically say, well, we warned you. There's a very funny thing about how the ETs work and how this whole thing works. Is they feel that they give you a warning, one warning, that is then justifies their subsequent actions, that they have dealt fairly with you. So in other words, if they warn you that, hey, this is we view this as subordination, and then you do it again, then they say, hey, we're justified in exterminating you because we gave you a warning and told you this is insubordination and we'll deal with it harshly. That is how they operate. And I've been given situations where I was given a warning. I heeded the warning. But I realized that the warning that was given to me was simply in their mind that justified then any actions they wanted to take if I didn't heed the warning. Crazy. That's not how our system works. Our system works as a trial by a jury of our peers. That's how it works. And a judge presiding, due process under the law, under the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, and all our rights that we have, that is how our system works. Is not giving. That's like if you go up to someone and say, I don't like you. I'm giving you a warning that if you don't get out of here, I'm going to hit you. And if they don't leave, then you go hit them and say, well, I'm totally justified because I warned them ahead of time. What is that? That is the belief system of the ETs. That is how they operate. They don't feel any guilt, compassion. They said, all I need to do is we'll give you a warning. If you don't heed it, it's your fault. It becomes your fault then. that's what we're up against. And how do you deal with that? We're not used to dealing with anything like that, especially in the United States. The problem is the United States is more naive than the rest of the world in a lot of ways. Actually, there are people throughout the entire planet who are really more awake than the Americans are. To just be very state the facts for you, those who have lived under tyranny are quite aware of how it works. We, United States, having not lived under tyranny, are very naive about this. There are people that come here from the Eastern Bloc and the former Soviet Union, and they look at this America and they say, oh my gosh, you people are so naive. It's happening right under your noses. The tyranny is coming, and we see it easily, completely obvious to us, and you are so naive, thinking, oh no, that could never happen here. Well, it's not true. It is happening very, very quickly. Very, very quickly. It's been happening, since the year 2000, well, since 2001, since 9/11, it has been happening very fast, and it's accelerating now, even more quickly. And of course, Americans naively think that, oh no, everything's going fine now. No, it's not. It's not at all. Constitution's being trampled on. Absolutely trampled on. So, we are naive in America. Drastically naive. And to say that it can never happen here and just to simply pretend, put our heads in the sand, is again extraordinarily foolish. And to call those who bring your attention to the naivete to say that they're somehow nut jobs or something is again extraordinarily foolish thing, position to take. It's exactly the position the ETs want you to take. They don't want you to recognize what's going on. They want it to be easy for them. They love it when things go easy for them. That's what they want. They want to waltz in here with nary a peep. That's what they want. But they want humans to do their dirty work for them. That's what they want. They don't want to get their hands dirty. They want it to all be easy for them. But really, we should not call anyone nut jobs or crazy or stuff like that. If we can really help it and just respect everybody's opinion. With a difference from ours, okay. Difference from ours. But maintain the love that we have for our neighbors, for our community, for our people, for the world, for all humans. Maintain the love and respect. Don't call names. Don't call names. The name calling on the internet is just absolutely crazy. It's just totally shocking. And it's so wicked. You know, we want to respond in kind, but we should not. Jesus said, turn the other cheek. Be forgiving. Maintain the affection and the love that we have. That if they're, no matter how terrible somebody is on this planet, human, if they're in need, what are we going to do? We're going to help them out. If they were starving, of course I'd give them food. Of course I'd give them food. Shelter and clothing, of course. You don't want to exterminate someone just because they have different viewpoints. Because we know what they really are is one with reality. They are the perfection that reality is. We all are. And we're just in this hypothetical scenario where we are engaging with complete insanity. And so people act out in very insane ways. And yet, we say, hate the sin, love the sinner. Hate the sin, love the sinner. And that is exactly the way we should be. Of course we hate the sin. Of course we hate the madness that's here. But we love the sinner. We're not throwing the baby out with the bathwater. So we maintain our loving compassion as we vet the situation. The ETs don't see it that way. They don't operate that way. They want to see compliance. They want to see order. They want to see submission, obedience, efficiency, subordination. They want the machine to be in charge. They want everything to run perfectly. They want the problems to be solved now. They don't want anything. They don't want any delays. And of course, life is super complicated and unexpected stuff happens. And that you can find yourself in all sorts of crazy entanglements, which I have found myself in recently, where maybe I make some mistakes. But I'm doing the best I can under the situation. And the ETs hate that. You know, there's zero tolerance policy is all coming from top down from the extraterrestrials. Instituting a zero tolerance policy. Zero tolerance policy. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine humans of their own accord instituting a zero tolerance policy? No way. We're way too compassionate and kind and intelligent for that. We understand that this place is a world of misery and suffering and sin and missing the mark. In other words, a hypothetical scenario. I mean, sin, being born into original sin, being born in this hypothetical scenario, or being born into nothing but crisis and difficulties and troubles. So of course we're going to stumble. What is this zero tolerance policy? That is the most insane nonsense I've ever heard. People make mistakes. People are put in situations where mistakes are all but guaranteed. They're put in straitjackets. The events conspire to cause them to stumble, and you gotta help them get back up. Jesus didn't come here to save the perfect. He came to save the sinners, those who were miserable, those who were stumbling. Of course, we're all stumbling. So some think they're not, but they are. So hate the sin, love the sinner. The ETs say zero tolerance policy. No mistakes, don't mess up. You cannot be quote unquote intolerant, meaning not tolerant of submitting to them is what they really mean. You got to be tolerant of situations that are really weird you don't like, meaning you have to be tolerant of them. And you can't even make one objection, meaning you can't be express insubordination to them at all. Insubordination freaks them out. You know, you get someone like in the military, one of these guys who is just too gung-ho and they're imbalanced, etc. And if you just disagree or they ask you to do something crazy that's dangerous to, maybe you have some people, people under your control, as far as a troop leader, maybe you're a leader of a squadron or something, and then you're asked to do something really crazy, it puts all your people in danger, in harm's way, for a wrong reason. You say, hey, now wait a minute, you know, immediately the gung-ho military person will freak out, and they'll say, I'm bringing you up on court-martial, as a matter of fact, I have the right to shoot you right now for insubordination. See, no insubordination is allowed. I remember my dad was flying a cargo plane. He flew the hump from Burma over into China, and also supplying the islands in the island campaign in the Pacific. Flew the big cargo planes with the heavy equipment and troop transports. And one time a general tried to hijack the plane on him and said, I don't like the way you're flying. The general freaked out. He was flying a general. The general freaked out and tried to kick him off the controls and take over the plane. And my dad told the co-pilot to pull a gun on the general, which he did, put the general under arrest on the plane. And the general told he was gonna court-martial my dad and have him executed for that insubordination. Well, the fact is that once you're in the air, the pilot has authority over the plane. And even it has rank over a general, okay? So he was right in what he did, because the general was crazy, was trying to obstruct the safe operation of the plane. So when they landed, they turned the general over, and the general said, arrest him, and then they took to the general on the ground, said, okay, what's the situation? They explained it, and they said, hey, general, you're wrong. That wasn't insubordination at all. He was perfectly in his rights to put you under protective arrest, because we have witnesses and testimony. You went crazy and tried to. You were endangering the life of the passengers on the plane. So, that was the right thing to do. Whereas the ETs don't get that at all. Insubordination to them is inexcusable, and there is no due process. You see, humans at least say, hey, we understand that. Wait, just because the general thinks he's the biggest big shot of all, that when you're in the air, it's the pilot's the one in charge. So the pilot knows how to fly the plane. He was a crack pilot flying a very dangerous mission, and the general had no business trying to interfere with the operations of the plane. Uh, I think the general was drunk, actually, and maybe had a episode of flipping out. You know, stress reaction of some sort, which happens. It happens. Which is why the pilot's in charge and has the right to put him under arrest, because sometimes what people they're transporting do flip out, have an episode, a psychotic episode or something, and they have to put them under arrest. So the ETs, though, they have zero tolerance, because they think they're flying this plane now. You see, they think they're the pilots of the world. But who made them pilots of the world? Well, they say, well, we consented to it. Yeah, but how is this consent arrived at? Through deception, through false promises, through lies. That's like, say, we elect someone president, and they say, well, we can do anything we want to do because you elected us. Well, yeah, but maybe it was your electability was in question, or maybe you weren't properly vetted, or you weren't transparent, you didn't tell us what you should have told us. So, in other words, our vote was done under false pretenses. We didn't know the full story at that time. So you can give consent when you're lied to. And that's not genuine consent, you see. So the ETs, the consent that they have is not genuine. It's not genuine because they've lied to the world. They've conned the world. They deceived the world. And they painted a false picture of what's going to take place. So it's not genuine consent in the first place. But even then, a zero-tolerance policy is insane. You have a right to due process. You have a right to state your case in front of a jury of your peers. But from their standpoint, no, they're judge, jury, and executioner. They absolutely are. Now, in the military, in times of combat, the commanding officer is the one that has highest rank that is there, does actually have the right to be judge, jury, and executioner under certain circumstances if a subordinate refuses an order which places the whole mission in extreme jeopardy, and they're trying to be completely insubordinate and resist. They do have the military law. They have the right to be judge, jury, and executioner at that point. That has happened before. Has happened. So they will institute all sorts of laws. There's a whole new legal system coming in place, actually. The foundations of that have already been laid. And the whole pretext and context of this new legal system is that the planet is dying. It's about to die. And we need to decree a planetary emergency. So it's literally like a time of war. That the laws are actually going to be very similar to the wartime laws. Like if you're engaged in an all-out combat where your survival was at stake, that there's a certain martial laws declared, there's certain, and the whole legal system becomes different. Like in World War II, the United States legal system was actually quite different. People were interred, for instance, on the West Coast, the Japanese citizens here, very law-abiding, good, peaceful citizens, were interred in internment camps just because we were afraid they might cooperate with the Imperial Army of Japan. And act as saboteurs, etc., even though there was no evidence they were doing so. So that was just, you know, complete violation of their rights. Total violation based on your ancestry. Germans' ancestors, people had German ancestry, were also treated very harshly. And many laws were passed that suspended our rights. Well, imagine that on a global scale when the pretext is that the planet itself is about to die, and if we don't take emergency measures right now, we're all going to die, and life as we know it in this planet is going to be wiped out. Imagine the legal system that's going to be implemented based on that pretext. Imagine what we rights are under those circumstances. Imagine how much the zero tolerance policy is going to be in place, which is basically any insubordination, people have the right to deal with it as they see fit, including execution. So it's headed that way, and the whole situation is turnkey ready right now. There have been those who have been working on a legal writ, a whole legal code like the, you know, the Napoleonic Code in for France, he imposed that upon Europe, a different legal system. Those who imperial conquerors always have a legal code ready to impose on those they conquer. Always. They have it already ready, finished product. And they will say, this is the code that now you are going to live under because it's necessary for your own safety and for the good of your fellow citizens. It's necessary. Because they will say, well, the deterioration of the atmosphere is happening so fast that if it's not a stop, if you don't take emergency measures, it's too late. It'll be too late. And there may be grains of truth about that. And yet, it doesn't justify the severity of the legal system, because they have a further agenda, which is to place themselves in permanent charge here. It's like a dictator who says, I'm suspending the all rights because we're in an emergency and I'm taking charge temporarily, like they're doing right in Egypt right now. This guy is declaring himself, you know, dictator essentially, and saying, but it's temporary. They always do that, don't they? It's temporary. And I'll cede back my authority after the crisis is over. And how often do they cede it back? Not very often. And so certainly in this situation, the ETs have no intention of ceding back authority at some later point. No intentions whatsoever. They will say, well, you need to be re-educated because you guys are really look what you did to the planet. You're very inferior. You need to go through an intense re-education process. And in other words, to learn how to accept the ET way, the ET way. And then once you accept that way, you won't want to go back to some other way. You'll see, oh, this is very superior, even though it's not. That's how it works. That's how the future will work. It's not at all surprising to those who have seen through. It's not at all surprising to hear this. Not at all. In fact, to say, duh. Of course, duh. What did you expect? What do we expect? Of course it's going to go that way. But it's amazing that those who want to get along with ETs, they're desperate. Of course, they don't want to be targeted, so they're desperate to say, we'll do anything you want us to do. And the ETs say, well, just pretend we don't exist. They say, okay. Just pretend none of this is going to happen. Okay. Just pretend when it does happen, it's all for your own good. Okay. Just have an attitude. Whoever points this out, just view them as crazy. And they say, okay, I'll do that. Whatever it takes. We'll do whatever you want. Just don't target us. We just want to get along. Can't we all get along? So we just want to, you know, have our big screen TV and our car and vacation and our booze and whatever else. And then, you know, that's good enough for us. Just don't target us. ET say, okay, here's what you got to do. Have zero tolerance for anybody who does any of this other stuff, though. Make sure you have zero tolerance for that. Get used to zero tolerance is what basically the people say. Okay. Anybody who says anything that is like going towards an open discussion, as it were, of a controversial subject, that's their zero tolerance for that. That's hate speech or something. Hate speech. Yeah, the whole hate speech thing was introduced by the ETs, designed to suppress any dissent towards their new world order, any dissent whatsoever, and get people used to suppressing it, doing their dirty work for them, suppressing so-called dissent. It's not dissent, it's just open examination of our options. Of course, you say, which way is do we want to go, our freedom, we have free will, which way do we want to choose, which path do we want to choose, do we want to go along with this or not? We have the right to do that, and what we're being trained in zero dissent policies, and this whole hate speech thing is to get used to viewing anybody who dissents as they're actually engaging in extremely bad hate speech, and therefore they are somehow genetically messed up. That's another part. They're going to say that those who dissenters are genetically predisposed to be incapable of going along with this new agenda, that they're genetically inferior and need to be genetically re-engineered or go through some type of intense process, therapy, some drug, the nanotechnology. They'll say, we have a nanotechnology to rearrange their deranged genetic code. See, somehow their DNA has somehow gotten deranged by some free radicals or something, free radicals, some derangement of their genetic code. And the ETs will say, oh, we have the cure for them. They won't say, oh, we don't mind the descent. They'll say, well, this descent actually comes because their DNA is deranged, and we have the cure for that. We have the nanotechnology to cure their derangement. And so it's all in their best interest, and we'll just give them a shot, and we'll put them into therapy, and they'll help them adjust to the healing of their DNA. That's how it will go. Healing their DNA. We can heal their DNA, and they'll see the way from that standpoint. They'll see the way. They won't engage in crazy descent. So let's all support the healing of their DNA. It will be marketed in that way. So you can see this is not a pretty picture as you vet it out. I've always been extraordinarily good at vetting out situations. Simply willing to do it, because that's what we should. We're responsible to do that. As human beings, we are responsible to make a choice. And ultimately, that's a choice to accept reality as it is. So we need to see situations that are not aligned with that and vet them out and distinguish between the two and differentiate. That's what we're supposed to do. That is the path of the Yoni, and even the Bhakti path too. The Bhakti path is supposed to differentiate between what is truly, where is love, where is the one relationship that already is. And to gravitate back to that one relationship with oneness, the oneness of reality in perfect relationship with the oneness of reality. They gravitate towards that. The Bhakti does that. The Yoni does that. Those in service do that. It's all, but that's very wise. They're not called to be stupid. But the ETs are calling us to be stupid. They're dumbing us down. They're dumbing humans being down. And of course, at some point, they'll tell us, hey, you humans, are you really stupid? And we'll agree, say, yeah, we are kind of stupid. We're just stupid sheeple. Because they've been dumbed down through this intense propaganda for so long. And people are becoming dumb. There's no question. When they're incapable of engaging in intelligent vetting and examining options without engaging in name calling and demonization, etc., then they have been dumbed down. And so then they'll just say, oh yeah, we deserve you, we need you because we're so dumb. And then the ETs will say, okay, you've got our consent now. Overlooking this massive, intense campaign to dumb the planet down, which they've been engaged in, by using attractive people to attract them to situations and entertainment that dumbs them down, and using the celebrity culture and using that to push this notion that anybody who disagrees or dissents with certain position is a hate monger, engaging in hate speech. And that's being used to cover a vast variety of stuff. It's actually very close to being used to cover all dissent. All dissent will soon be seen as hate speech. All dissent. We're all supposed to hold rallies in support of the ETs being here now, welcoming them. There'll be massive rallies around the world welcoming, and these superstar musicians and entertainers will be headlining these massive global rallies. You know, they'll have a huge stadium and a big sports complex, maybe gigantic soccer stadiums that hold, 500,000 people, come a million people. There'll be rallies of millions of people around the world, and these entertainers, these superstar entertainers, will headline these rallies. As a matter of fact, I was asked long ago to be one of these headliners, musician entertainers. I could have done it. And they told me, you can be super famous and super helpful for the world, and you're going to be holding these gigantic concerts. And I told them to go to hell. I said, no way. I know what you're up to. I'm not going to do it. And they got super mad at me. Super enraged. Insubordination. They felt it was drastic insubordination. And I said, no. No way. Not going to do it. I definitely could have done it. But there are those in the world now. I don't want to name names. I'm not targeting anybody. I know pretty well who they're going to be, because they've been practicing for it already, holding all these world tours and getting ready for it, because there will be massive rallies in the world, super celebrations, as it were, welcoming the ETs here and showing the world spirit of cooperation and galactic participation. And the ETs will say that this is a sign that this planet has elevated into the fourth dimension and is now part of a global confederacy that they've graduated. And so these huge celebrations and rallies will be taking place all over the planet. And people will be just ecstatic, as it were, to realize that we graduated somehow. We've made it. We've accepted the ETs. We said, welcome. Our world is your world. And this is a sign that this is the proof that we somehow graduate into the galactic family. That's what's going to happen. And these big superstars who've been around for a while, and some other ones that you don't even know about who will come to the front, we'll put on these shows, these big shows. It'll be a big thing. It'll go on and on and on and on and on. Be a huge party. And I was intensely recruited to participate in that and to write songs for it. Actually, when I refused to be one of the headliners, they asked me to write songs for it and to compose music for it. And I said, no, I'm going to compose music for a counter celebration, a celebration of accepting reality as it is. So they have it all planned out, and they've been recruiting very talented people, entertainers, especially musicians, to take part in it. I could have been incredible if I decided to go in that direction, but also I would have been incredibly stupid and incredibly misguided and incredibly regretful of doing that. Just think of the regret that those headliners who are going to go out there and put on incredible shows, getting us to accept the ETs and enabling the whole situation to go forward with, eventually, as it all turns so terrible, so wicked. Imagine how they're going to feel. Say, oh my God, I led all these people to their slaughter. It's essentially what they're doing. Imagine the regret the people, for instance, in Nazi Germany had to set up all those huge rallies, that were patriotic rallies, welcoming the rule of Hitler and his henchmen, propaganda experts who thought they were simply helping Germans restore their German pride and German nationalism and restoring the greatness that was Germany. They didn't. Later on, they said, "Holy cow!" They were super regretful for facilitating the rise to power of all this stuff. They didn't quite see it that way at the time. They thought they were doing Germany a favor, just like these headliners think that they are doing the world a favor by helping us get used to and accept the ETs here. So the ETs are going to give us all this technology and free energy, etc., and usher in a golden age. They think they're doing the world a massive favor. But they're not. And deep down they know they got in bed with the ETs. These headliners, these big entertainers, they're in bed with the ETs. Have been for a long time. How do you think they get to the top? You have to be in bed with ETs to get to the top these days. You have to be. Because they're in control of the entertainment industry and the media. And the media complex, it's all one complex. Corporate media entertainment is all one complex. It's under the control of the ETs and their proxies here. And so, if you're willing to play ball with them, you literally can become super famous and hold these rallies and not only perform for millions of people live, but also be beamed around the entire world. These concerts will be beamed all over the world, and people will be watching on big screens in civic centers. They'll be watching on their home theater systems, which is a large part of so many people getting home theater systems right now, and the big screens. So it becomes epic. It becomes epic. There is, what it will be is the ETs will be, it'll be announced that we've made a treaty with the extraterrestrials, that they do exist and a treaty, and they're actually going to share incredible technology with us to save the planet from global warming and ozone depletion and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, some of the drastic problems that we have. And that then there will be celebrations where, what will happen is there'll be celebrities on this planet that we think are really, really great humanitarian celebrities. They will throw these huge concerts. These huge concerts will be beamed by satellite all over the planet. Again, civic centers, stadiums, sports venues, people will go to those places and they'll be free. It'll be free. And most of the world will go to those concerts. And then during those concerts, as they're putting on these incredible shows, and people are sit there in their sports arenas and in their home theaters. Many people have home theaters now. So many people, really, with surround sound, and they've got their popcorn and their drinks, and they got this huge plasma or LED or LCD, whatever, their televisions, and they'll have block parties, etc., inviting people over to these places. Everybody will get with it. It'll happen like that, like wildfire. And then during these huge concerts, okay, good luck, during these huge concerts, the headliners, the people that we look up to, the world, look at the celebrity, the super celebs, will say, I have an announcement for you. I have a special guest. You know how they do that in concerts. Like, say, everyone, we've got a special guest tonight to introduce to you. It's my honor. It's my privilege. It's my incredible privilege to bring out on stage right now several of our space brothers. And people go, oh my gosh. And they'll come out. They'll probably be the Nordics. The tall blondes that we have been acculturated to think are really cool and loving. And they'll come out on stage and people just, oh, you know, they'll just start fainting. People start fainting with ecstasy. It's like we've already run some trial runs for this where, you know, in election campaigns where all this glamour and glitz was the one is here and people are fainting. It was like that. It was a trial run. This, and then it will actually happen where the tall blonde Nordics will be brought out on stage during these super celebration concerts, like a Woodstock. It'll be like Woodstock. It'll only be like one day. It'll be like a 3-day thing or a week thing or something. It'll be really big, big stuff. And they'll be brought out on stage and they say, we'd like you to say some words to us. And they'll say, we're so grateful to be here that you've accepted us. And We love you so much, and we're so glad you finally saw the light. And they'll give some great speech, or it'll be like the biggest event in the history of the planet will take place, supposedly. But it'll be really the worst event in the history of the planet. That's what it'll really be. And yet it will be seen as the most historic event in the history of the planet, which is, of course, why we have this super historic president. I guess this is all historic, leading up to something super, super historic, right? Which is and of course, at some point in one of these big, big celebrations, the POTUS, President of the United States, will be there, and he will come out on stage with these ETs, and he will officially greet them with a handshake and a hug, and say, I officially accept your presence here and welcome you here. And people worldwide will be watching this live. Worldwide will be watching it live. And the staging will be incredible. You know, the stage master from Hollywood will be part of this, building this incredible staging. And it will be done in that way. It will not be done in the Oval Office or something like that. No, it's going to be done through entertainment and these big star, superstar, celebrity musicians and concerts, etc. And then bringing them out on stage, and it'll be led up to that situation, and people will be brought up to a fever pitch. I mean, it'll make the people who did the massive rallies, Nuremberg rallies and the German rallies, make them look like amateurs. You know, the way that they'll be orchestrated, the propaganda of orchestrating this will be done that way. And so you're watching this with all your family and friends and your neighbors and your community and your city, and everybody's watching this together, and it will feel like the seminal point in the history of this planet. And people won't even question that. They'll say, without question, this is the greatest moment of my life. They will say that. Nothing else even comes close. My God, live on TV, the president has met and embraced extraterrestrials on stage, and everyone in the world is seeing this live. And it may continue on with other heads of states also in other places. I'm just using this as a key concept scenario for you to see. how it can work and how it's going to work. And when I talk about the crystallization of consciousness, some people have said, now everything will be the same. No, not true. It's all turnkey ready for this event to take place. Now you can see what I'm talking about. You have almost the whole entire population of the planet watching this event live and seeing the complete embracement and acceptance of the ETs on stage in this huge celebration that's going on, this party, and then the party continues after that on and on and on for weeks, maybe all around the world. It may start out with the POTUS, this huge concert, and then this surprise announcement coming on stage, accepting the ETs, and having the ETs sit with him in his box there, watching the concert, and then the concert will continue on for days and days and days throughout the whole planet. People will be celebrating, and other heads of state will also introduce and accept the ETs in their countries. Head of state of European countries, South American, Asian countries, the whole place will have big ceremonies accepting the ETs and saying, thank you so much, we accept you here in our country, in our world. We have full acceptance of you now. And all the people of that country watching those things will go on and on and on. A big celebration, all pre-orchestrated, and everyone in the world is going to see it. Almost very few people in the world will be unaware of this taking place. Almost everybody will be aware of it and maybe even see it. It'll be publicized in all the media, all the press, all the television channels. That's all they'll be on, all of its channels. Nothing but that. Wall-to-wall coverage. And it'll be saying, as this is, you are super, super fortunate to be part of this because this is the greatest moment in the history of planet Earth. It'll be sold like that. How many people will be able to truly dismiss this with a laugh, or not even pay attention to it? How many? What percentage? That is a question you need to ask yourself. I can certainly dismiss it. I cannot even pay attention to it. I know that I can just not even watch it at all, like it never happened. I didn't watch the presidential campaigns. I paid no attention to them. I didn't watch the speeches. I didn't watch anything. I saw what it's all about. I said, okay, I know what it's about. Why waste time? And then I just dismissed it and paid no attention to any of it. Same with catastrophes, etc. I just dismissed it and paid no attention to it. Didn't pay any attention to 9/11. I already knew what would happen. I saw the whole thing take place ahead of time. So I was already aware of what's going on. And I said, hey, it's go time. We got to start gravitating towards accepting reality as it is. We really got to go all out. So I just went all out. So I'm able to do it. But what percentage of the world is able to do this? So if you think that the world is going to stand up and reject this, you got another thing coming. Because it's going to be presented very cleverly with all these super celebrities in this massive free concert with some huge announcement is going to take place. It will be done that way. And people, the momentum will build as it goes, and it'll spread like wildfire throughout the whole planet, like wildfire. Within a matter of days, everybody will suddenly be in lockstep with the situation and have pretty much accepted it. And the resistance will just be crushed. 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 It will literally happen that fast. Within days, if not sooner, the opposition, the will to not consent to this will be crushed. And just those who saw this coming ahead of time got into a place of safety, and who are abiding with those who have accepted reality as it is, who realize that this is the real way, they won't be crushed. They won't be crushed, but they will be seen as the aliens now. They will be viewed as the aliens on this planet. That is literally the changeover that's going to happen, is those human beings who dismiss this whole thing and say, that's not the way, we're going to the way of accepting reality as it is, they now will be seen as the aliens on this planet. And the aliens will be seen as one of part of humanity, of all one, part of all oneness of humanity. Those who don't go along with the alien agenda will be seen as the aliens and as totally weird and frightening and bizarre. That is, and it will literally happen in a turnkey fashion, as the lack of consent will be crushed on this planet, like a free fall crushing of it. Which is why I say you got to get out of Dodge ahead of time. And I'm laying down the tracks for you. I'm paving the road for you to see it and give your consent to say, hey, now I see what's really going to happen. it will happen that way. And I wasn't sure if I wanted to spill the beans on this. It's going to put me in trouble or something. I don't consent to any trouble for this. Because the way I'm doing it is right, and I'm not consenting to any getting in trouble for spilling the beans this way at all. It's right and just to do so, because the cleverness of it is the sudden crushing of any resistance. A blitzkrieg. It is the blitzkrieg of all blitzkriegs that's coming up. It will make the German blitzkrieg look like child's play. Child's play. Because it will be done through celebrities and entertainment on a global scale. Like, this is the greatest thing that's ever happened to the planet. And people are ripe for that. They're thirsty for it. They said, wow, I'm here on this planet for some really important announcement, for something really important. And I know the greatest thing that's ever happened on this planet is going to happen very soon. And they're ready for it. They've really been ready for it, prepared for it. Celebrity culture has prepared the planet for this. And again, I just dismiss celebrities like they're nothing. You know, just, they're nothing to me. They're one in Christ with me. But as terms of importance, nothing. I don't see them as a celebrities at all. I'd have them over for tea, just like I'd have anybody over for tea. If they're my neighbor, hi, you know, say hi to them or something. But I don't see celebrities as having any special importance whatsoever. So it's easy for me just to dismiss all this stuff, but I had to work at it. I had to work at it ahead of time, because they were pressing the celebrity culture on us. And I was given numerous entreaties to join up with that celebrity culture and be part of it. And if I wasn't willing to be a headliner, then at least I could write the music for these celebrations, which I did. Actually, I didn't realize what celebration I was being used for. I wanted to use it for the celebration for those who are hanging out with those who have accepted reality as it is. Those who are willing to do that, that's what I wanted to write the music for. But it really could easily be used for this celebration that's coming up. So that's why I haven't released the music. I haven't made videos about that. I've been sitting on it, because I said, you know what, this stuff could actually be used to welcome the ETs here. Could very well be utilized for that. So I haven't consented to this music to be utilized in any way. I'm sitting on it. Some of the stuff for the celebration, I actually wrote an entire soundtrack from some huge global celebration. But I said, you know, I'm not convinced that this is legit here. Let me vet this situation more. I was always vetting it, saying, okay. So I might have been tricked into that, thinking I was preparing it for welcoming those who accepted reality as it is into the world. But the truth is, they don't need any music to be welcome. Our welcoming for them is simply hanging out with them in quietness, just hanging out in peace, in quietness and stillness, just hanging out, soaking it in. We don't need any music, really don't. We don't need any fancy clothes either. We can wear what we want to wear. If we want to celebrate, we can celebrate. Sure, we can celebrate. But it doesn't have to be done in the way that I feel I wrote the songs. The way I wrote the songs is not necessary. Not necessary. So I'm still in the process of vetting the entire situation and coming extremely clear about it. That it's very likely all those songs, all that effort, all that expense was simply being utilized in a very clever way to actually be used by these headliners as songs to welcome the ETs and part of the celebration, because some of those songs I wrote were extremely good songs and absolutely could be used in that way. And would give a whole spiritual context to the situation, as if this was some ultimate spiritual moment in the history of the planet, which is how it's going to be presented. It's going to be presented as the greatest moment in the history of the planet, as some super spiritual moment that proves how spiritually advanced the planet is, that we finally get it. And there's all these teachers and gurus running around the planet telling us how we're almost there. This planet is really spiritually advanced. They're preparing the planet for this celebration is what they're doing. And I've been aware of that. I've not been fooled by them. They're preparing for that event to make it seem like this is the height of spirituality, to worship these ETs when they come here. That proves how spiritually advanced we are, to accept them and do what they tell us to do. Just adjusting this. So, I continue to sit on those songs. It's not the one I played here. It feels like the country. That's one that actually is geared towards relocation. That's fully legit. Again, though, we don't need a song and a dance to hang out with those who have accepted reality as it is. We can come with empty hands. We don't have to come with a soundtrack. We don't have to have any soundtrack. We just come and say, thank you for being here. I'm really, really pleased that you're here. And let me sit down and enjoy. They'll say, enjoy. They'll say, I'm glad to be here too. Very pleased to be here. Enjoy. And they'll enjoy our presence too, because they see us as they see themselves, as the one relationship. Perfect relationship with the all, with the one, with everything that is. Perfect relationship. They see us that way. So they're enjoying our presence just as much as we're enjoying theirs. That is the truth. So they'll say, welcome, welcome, welcome. Glad you're here. Enjoy, enjoy, enjoy. Let's just hang out. Just enjoying the perfect relationship we have with all that is. Just abiding in that. Just abiding, like Ramana, just abiding, enjoying it. Smiling, of course, smiling and enjoying it. That's it. No song and dance is necessary. Now, maybe at some point something might be, but it's not really necessary. Sometimes if people are all kind of nervous and in awe, it helps to ground them to sing, to say call and response sort of thing, which is in India is called Sankirtana. And they do that to just kind of ground people sometimes, but we might not even need that. May not even need that. If so, I can certainly lead that. Definitely I could lead some call and response stuff if needed. Or if not, take it or leave it. I don't care either way. If necessary for music, I can compose it or perform it or lead the call and response, whatever. I can do that, piece of cake. But I'm not planning to. I don't expect to. And I don't have any attachment to either one. Either way, it's just the same to me. Doesn't matter either way. We could just hang out in silence and quietude. Or we could come up with, on the spot, we could compose some celebration of, you know, joy, bliss, just gratitude, express our gratitude in some musical way or something. Sure, why not? Or either that or not. Either do it or not do it. It's all the same. It's all the same. That's the attitude I have, so. Very important to get this going before the announcement is made. When is the announcement going to be made? I don't like setting dates at this point. People don't like that either. But I have a sense of it. I have a sense of it. Maybe I'll slip it into these videos. Let me just say 2013. Let's say probably during 2013 it is going to be made. Maybe the earlier part of it rather than the later part of it. Okay, that's a general something that you can read between the lines. We'll see. Maybe the ETs are flexible too. They're trying to figure out when should we do it, when's the opportune time. But they already have a time picked out. But it's important for us to get going, for sure. Big boost to get going, for sure. So when this huge announcement and this huge party is going to be a global celebration, the likes of which this planet has never experienced whatsoever, it's going to be Twittered and Facebooked and smartphoned, and it's going to just be, you know, this unbelievable party is going to take place on this planet. How do you sit that party out? Well, I want to tell you, I'm the greatest at sitting parties out. I have sat every party out that's come down the expressway on this planet. I've been invited to so many parties, and I always turned them down, turned everything down. I said, no, I'm just going to hang out with my wisdom books and contemplate, that's it. So I have a long, long history of sitting out celebrations and parties. I refuse to even pay any attention to them. Long history of that. Like, what, 2000, millennium? I paid no attention to it. No attention to it. Whenever there's a big global thing, I pay no attention to it. So I've rehearsed it. I'm prepared for that, rehearsed it. I'm very used to it. So I can certainly do it and help others do it too. But there has to be something very attractive alternative, because it's going to be tough. If you're just hanging out on your own, ooh, that's going to be a very tough one for you, to be honest. Even tough for me. Even tough for me. Maybe too tough, actually. I can do it, but you're going to be seen as super crazy and insubordinate, something mentally wrong with you if you do that. You will be seen that way. Because people say, hey, this is the greatest thing that's ever happened in the history of this planet. This is the thing we've all been waiting for. And you're not the slightest bit interested, and you must be mentally defective. They will literally see it that way. So it'll be very tough for you. Part of the reason why I've been making these videos here is to get you prepared, if possible, to have a video alternative. Let's say you're in your house and this celebration party is going on, and I want you to be able to have an alternative where you can watch a video of something that's even better than this big party, which would be someone who's accepted reality as it is, and those hanging out with them would be vastly superior, and you have an alternative to that. So you can say, well, this is my path, and this is, for me, is much more important, because they're having a celebration too at this time, and I don't want to miss that. And then of course they'll say, well, you can watch both of them. You say, well, no, that's kind of like mixing oil and water, because it's a totally different direction. And it would really dilute both and make both feel unappetizing. It would just my mind would all get messed up. So I don't want to do both. I want to choose, and I'm going to choose this one. This one's better. So that's part of the end game, because I understand that not everybody is necessarily going to be in the presence of those who have accepted reality as it is. I certainly expect to be. But if I'm not, I certainly hope somebody can broadcast it live so people can watch that during this global celebration. I certainly expect that. So maybe, not maybe, I am going to get you even more ready for this. Maybe I'm going to throw on all sorts of stuff, start a preparatory celebration, as it were. Like a rehearsal. We need a rehearsal. Maybe I'll start a rehearsal. I don't know. Maybe some of you were like, I won't like that. What is he doing? Who does he think he is, etc. But I'm trying to lay the context down for getting ready for this, so you can say, hey, I know where to go. I know what to watch when this global celebration starts taking place, where the ETs come out and are feted, the super big fet. I mean, you think the feting of the princess getting married or something, you know, royalty getting married is big. Oh, this fet is going to be incredible. This maybe goes on for months, or the whole year, actually, of feting this fact the ETs are here. It'll go the whole doggone year. I mean, they'll be going to be feted everywhere, and all those top socialites will be vying and fighting to have them, ETs, come to their soirees, and all the movers and shakers and high society and the A-list people will attend, and people will be desperate to just have a glimpse of these celebrities. These will now be the super celebrities of the planet. And of course they'll look super glamorous. I mean, they'll look more beautiful than Brigitte Bardot, for goodness sakes. You know, they'll be these blonde Nordic sex goddesses, basically. They'll just be look so elegant and beautiful and sexy, and people will just say, oh my God, these are like celebrities beyond anything we could possibly imagine. And they'll just line up in parades down Broadway just to catch a glimpse of them. Just to catch a glimpse of them. This is like super royalty on the planet now. And people just say, oh my God, the ones that we were waiting to come have now come, and we want to see them. Meanwhile, I'll be hanging out some place in some sanctuary, not even paying any attention to it. I'll be hanging out with those who have accepted reality as it is. That, and those are way beyond, I mean, immeasurably better than... Just imagine if you could hang out with Rahman Harshi. Just imagine. Would you choose to do that? Or would you choose to be in some audience of a parade down Broadway in New York, just desperately trying to catch a glimpse of these tall Nordic, you know, celebrity ETs? Which would you choose? Think about it. Think about it, because you're going to have to choose. Very soon, you're going to have to make that choice. I'd rather be with Ramana. I'd rather be hanging out with Ramana Maharshi. Maybe there's a little tinge of disappointment. Oh, I'm going to miss this most important global event in the history of humanity. Ever. I'm going to miss it. This totally historic stuff going on. All the stuff going on, I'm going to miss it. A little tinge, probably. But I'm sure that's going to disappear very rapidly when you're in the presence. Like if you're in the presence of Ramana Maharshi, that would disappear very quickly. And you'll say, ah, I made the right choice. This is fabulous. Just fabulous. Holy cow. I wish everybody was here. So you are going to have to make that choice very soon. And I'm doing everything I can to get you ready with that. And I hope you indulge what you might see as slight eccentricity, because I am putting it in the context of what is going to happen. And you do need to get ready for it. So I don't know if I can be a little eccentric as far as doing stuff. I don't know what I can do to help out. But maybe you can do some stuff that just kind of, hey, gets us ready. I don't know. I don't know what else I'm going to do with my time. I already vetted the whole situation. I already put out the whole context. Now, what else am I going to do? That's the question I have with me. The question is, what do I do with my time? That is the tough question. Between now and coming across one who has accepted reality as it is, which I fully anticipate I will do, What do I do? I don't know. Is there some way to have a split screen with a picture of one of these gurus and then me here acting as if I'm in their presence? That's something like that. Or being in a slight celebratory mood, putting on some flower lays and just showing that we can celebrate too. We can have our celebration too. That is something that's very important. We can have our celebration too. Now, the music that I composed is designed to be part of that celebration, but it could, if it comes out to her, it could be twisted to be used as part of the celebration to welcome the ETs on this planet. Now, you think, well, the ETs coming out are going to be some of the grays, you know, the malevolent grays, those little, I got some words for them I won't use, but they're yuck, they're nasty looking, you know, and they're very intellectual, though, I'll tell you that. They don't look so good, though. So, no, they won't. Those aren't the ones that are coming out. Those who think the aliens are coming out, landing on the White House lawn, and the grays come out of their spaceships, forget it. That's not going to happen. There's also some ETs called the Tall Nordic Blondes. And they look very much like humans, like Swedish, or, you know, like Nordic. Okay, they look very Nordic. And they're tall, very tall, like 6'8", 7 foot, or 6'9". They're tall, they're big, they're tall. But they're very graceful, and they look, from the standpoint of a human, they look like a giant kind of, but very pleasing to our eye. They have very pleasing features. They look very kind of beautiful and sexy. Very sensuous and beautiful and sexy. And the hair, just the way they look is so, you know, they look like the gods of ancient times, of Greek and Roman times almost. And those are the ones who are going to come out, who will present the face of the ETs to the world. And so what the world doesn't understand is that they're actually working for the Greys, who are working for the Draconians. So that won't be told. They think, oh, these are the ETs, these wonderful blonde Nordics, how wonderful. And we'll be conned that way too. So what do I do? What do I do with my time? Get our celebration going. I don't want to bring out these songs too early. I don't know. I really don't know what to do. Because again, these songs could easily be transferable over to developing some intense devotion to the ETs, the Nordic Blondes. It could easily be used that way, as a matter of fact. It's probably better just to sit on it and don't use that stuff until we see what the situation really is. That's how I feel. I believe that is very much the right way to go about it. So let's see what I can do to help out here. Because I know there are those in the world who, they want to sit this one out. They want to fold their hands, say, I don't want to be part of this world celebration. Forget it. I want an alternative. And you got to be careful, because people will become very ecstatic when the ETs come out and the celebration goes on throughout the year. People will become very ecstatic. And worshipful of them and throwing flowers at them. And I mean, it will just become this unbelievable celebration, really. People go out of their minds, the elaborate parties, etc. Holy cow. People will just be full tilt, party with the most elaborate stuff imaginable. Whoa, the flowers, oh, I'm telling you. So if I come out with some of that flower stuff, which I could, people could very easily get that and then have that twisted into falling into the celebration for the ETs. They would say, oh, look at all the beautiful flowers. Oh, yeah. Look at all the beautiful songs. Oh, yeah, I want to be part of that. So we'll see how it goes. Maybe just keep it very simple. Very simple. Which this set here is very simple. You see, the set here is simple by design. It's just got a few palm fronds, a bare wall, and a seat. That's it. Very simple. That is very much like hanging out with those who've accepted reality as it is. It can be very simple. It's not an elaborate production. You don't have to throw flowers all over the place. You don't have to drape them in flowers. You don't have to have elaborate songs. You don't have to have elaborate backdrop. You do not. And they don't have to be sitting up on a throne higher than you are. One of the things that I don't like about, I wouldn't say don't like it. It's just not necessary in satsang to have the one giving satsang up on a dais, as it were. Sure, people want to see them. I get it. I get that. The one thing I don't get is when someone is brought up to the dais and they sit in the chair and they have the inquiry one-on-one with the guru, that the stool is always short. And the one who's comes up from the audience is always in a lower position looking up to the teacher. I really think that should be looked at. The other part, being on a dais so everyone in a big crowd can see them. Of course. That's people want to see them. So that's probably somewhat necessary. Although Ananda Mayama often just sat on the floor. She'd just sit on the floor and the other people would be watching her. She didn't necessarily. Sometimes she'd be on a dais if there was a situation of teachers teaching or something. She'd go on a dais too. Various ways, actually. But the situation of giving someone the small stool to sit on as they're interacting and talking, that's actually a therapeutic move that's used in therapy, where it puts the person that you're talking to in a very authoritative position over you. I would much rather see it that you come to a seat and you're level, eye to eye with them. And not that you have your back to the audience, that you kind of are looking at the audience too, like sort of sitting next to the guru, next to the guru, putting yourself there, saying, and the guru, and just taking in, realizing, hey, I have a relationship with all that is too, a loving relationship, perfect relationship with all that is too. And this one here is no different than I am. We're not different. They're not greater than I am. I'm not lesser in reality. It's the only difference is they have accepted reality as it is. I have still have some reservations, but that's it. That is it. No difference. No difference. And in reality, we're the same. One and the same. So there has to be a better way to do that. Ananda Mayama was great at that. Boy, she deferred. So humble and deferring to everyone, and she just sit on the floor. So it is more like that. And again, the sets can be very It's plain. It's easy to get carried away with... Maybe I can do videos that show you how I got carried away. Because I've been through it all. I've been through this whole thing. And I can show you how I got carried away. I did get carried away. I admit it. I got too devotional, which overrode my wisdom. You see, the heart has to be balanced with the head. If you get carried away with the heart, you get carried away with devotion, it can go overboard, which will happen with the ETs. You stop vetting the situation. You don't vet it at all. You just want to drape them in flowers. No. Those of you who have accepted reality as don't need to be draped in flowers, they don't want you to get carried away. No, don't get carried away. Just sit here quietly. Just recognize that you are one with reality, and I'm not greater than you are. No one's greater. There's no hierarchy in reality whatsoever. Just get used to that. Which is kind of where Krishnamurti was coming from, actually. Where, like, not in my mind, loud pomp and circumstance, because it was the traditions of India, but also she also emphasized very Spartan kind of situations with no pomp and circumstance, too. So she kind of went with the flow, but was in control of the whole situation, knowing, and you didn't want to let it go too far. There was very strict, very strict. You can't let devotion run rampant over your clarity and wisdom of the head, so to speak. You cannot, because then you start making mistakes. And then that could easily be translated into throwing your devotion to someone who's not worthy of it, meaning those who have not accepted reality as it is and are trying to put you in the direction of solving the problem of annihilation. You end up getting devoted to that, which then the wheels come off eventually. It's very bad. So there has to be a very keen awareness of this whole thing about how it's all staged. Very keen awareness, or else it could start going in the wrong direction. So I've been working on this for a long time, and I'm aware of the whole thing about staging, the whole thing about music, the whole thing about how you hang out with that, everything about it. Again, publicizing it, that can get out of hand too, etc., etc. You really have to have a keen appreciation of what the troubles could be, and work within those parameters. So I don't know what I'm going to do. I mean, I could do videos that show you how it does get out of hand, which might seem kind of weird. I don't know, because I went through that. I vetted. I've gone through that whole situation of celebration ahead of time. What's it going to be like when the ETs get here, when our devotion gets super high and out of hand and maybe not properly put in the right context? Because obviously, worshiping the ETs instead of hanging out with those who accepted reality as it is completely wrong. Such wrong. Big mistake. And the emotionalism and the devotion of all this stuff is what is going to drive this. When people get into that state, they feel that their intellect, not their intellect, but their clarity, the voice of clarity is somehow interfering with their devotion, the intensity of their devotion, so they reject it. And so you can't reach them. Once they start worshiping the ETs, how can you reach them? They feel as if you're somehow interfering with their experiencing of something profound. It's a big problem. Ooh, cold out here now. It's a chilly day here. Chilly day around the bay, really. So, I know it's a long video, but I'm hopefully covering a lot of ground here fast for you. So if you've watched this, you probably realize we've really encompassed an enormous context here, and starting to see the road is starting to be paved, and it's like, interestingly, my account, when YouTube suddenly changed without any notification or asking for us for input or anything, suddenly arbitrarily changed the whole format of YouTube. And by the way, it doesn't fit properly on my computer screen anymore. It's all too far over to the right, and there's all the space in the left. The videos don't show up properly. It's crazy. I mean, they just have so many bugs in it. It's just a mess, and I don't like the setup at all. what happened with my account is suddenly the option to put my videos as Creative Commons is no longer there, no longer shows up. And I did a Creative Commons search, and actually almost nobody's Creative Commons are showing up. A lot of people have had their ability to put their videos as Creative Commons have disappeared. And they say, well, that can happen when your account is not in good standing. Well, my account is in good standing. It says all the things are, you say you're in good standing in every way. Even though there have been some bogus claims to third-party content, which I use Creative Commons music, like Walter Mazzacaro, I got it from Jamendo. It was Creative Commons. And retroactively now apparently it's being claimed as third-party content, which is totally I've had that music from Creative Commons stuff be claimed as third-party content. Totally, you know, bogus. I didn't do anything wrong. But my account is in good standing, but my ability to put it in Creative Commons has been eliminated. Well, I take this as some kind of sign. How to work with that? One thing I could do is I could put the videos It's not private, but it's unlisted. And then send out a bulletin to the subscribers with the link, and then they can visit that link. It's just not, you can't find it via search on YouTube. If you know the link, you can view the video that way, and it's not in Creative Commons, so people don't have a right to use it. That way you could see, I could show you some stuff that might get you ready, how I kind of went overboard and what not to do and what to do and some of the music, etc. You could look at it without it being publicly searchable or Creative Commons, or people feel they can use it. So maybe I'm supposed to segue over into that. You can also make it private, which then only those who I have to invite them. They have to be somehow invited to view the movie, and then there's some limit, like only 25 people can invite friends. They have to be officially signed up as a friend, and only 25 people can watch those videos. Theoretically, I could do that too. Because I know there's some hardcore viewers here, very hardcore viewers, whether it's 25 or 50 or whatever, I'm not sure, who I could invite as friends to watch some stuff that is very cutting edge, actually, in preparation. I could do that, and you would see it's really very strongly cutting edge, like super devotional stuff, that you could see that how that could actually be in play with the ETs, and how those who have accepted reality as don't need that. They don't need it. And you can somehow get over it ahead of time, you know, vet it, the whole situation ahead of time, which is what I did. It's called fire breaking, which is like when people, like there's a forest that's all dry and there's a danger of a fire. What the fire people do is they do a controlled burn in a certain area, and that makes a fire break. So when the wildfire happens and there's a wind pushing the fire, there's this big fire break that it cannot jump over that fire break and spread. That's called fire breaking, which is what I did in my life. With the grace of God, I actually took on a lot of situations that it seems like I'm aligning with the whole crazy celebration that's coming up, but it was fire breaking that whole thing. So it could not jump. I already have familiarity with the whole situation. It cannot jump over that situation. It cannot spread. There's someone here. Hold on, I might have to get cut out. Anyway, I will consider these things, okay? Whether it be unlisted or private videos or something. All right, very great. That's it.